This is the one of the building block of the blockchain, which is trying to which is improving the trust among the untrusted entities in the blockchain. But there are other consensus mechanisms are there. Why other consensus mechanisms are developed? If you see here, yesterday we have seen that for calculating the hash value for a given message, it takes lot of time. And here each node has to spend time by incrementing the nonce value to become the successful for mining the block. Like this, all the nodes are doing the same thing. But at the end, only one node will be successful and one node will get reward. Other nodes' computational effort will get wasted. So if you see overall in the blockchain, there are thousands of nodes. All the nodes are doing same process. But out of those thousands of nodes, for one iteration of the transaction or for one iteration of block adding to the blockchain, only one node will be successful. That means it is wasting a lot of resources and energy. Wasting resources means computational resources from each node and also energy. So proof of work is widely used in the Bitcoin, but it is wasting large amount of resources such as electricity, computational power, and also it is affecting the scalability and speed because it takes a lot of time to mine the block. And as we have seen that to get the block's hash value with the more preceding number of zeros, means if the blockchain size is increasing, this is again becoming a complex task, or it is time consuming task when blockchain size is increasing, because once blockchain size is increasing, every time you are lowering the hash value of the blocks, and due to that it is affecting the scalability and speed of the transaction. So once that chain is becoming longer, the throughput of the blockchain is very less. So to address this issue, Ethereum has come up with the proof of stake. Here, in this proof of work, the main motive about the consensus that who can mine the block so that others can trust it, that this block is valid and this should be updated to each updated at the each node. Ultimately, all the nodes will have to spend something, or they have to show their richness that we are able to spend something to create the block so that our blocks will be valid. So in here, nodes are in proof of work, nodes are spending their computational power, but in proof of stake, the nodes which are having the higher number of ethers. So in Bitcoin, the currency is called as Bitcoin block. In Bitcoin blockchain, it is currency is Bitcoin. In Ethereum, currency is the, or cryptocurrency is the ethers. So whatever nodes are having the higher number of ethers, they can get a more chance to become the validator of the blocks. So proof of stake replaces the computational work with the random selection of process, where the chance of successful mining with proof of stake is proportionally related to the wealth of the validator. So those nodes which are having more number of ethers, they can get more chance for mining the block. Practical badger time fault tolerance that we have already seen yesterday. In that, we require at least 2/3 of the network nodes to behave honestly. Means whatever data is coming, whatever data are mined, that at least 2/3 of networks should behave honestly. But again, this is a problem. This PBFT is widely used in Hyperledger, Linux Foundation, and Tendermint. But in this consensus mechanism, the problem is if the network size is growing, again, it is difficult to get these 2/3 of network nodes. And once that network size is increasing, it is again affecting the speed and scalability edge like the proof of work. Then delegated proof of stake has come. In that, every network user are voting to the particular number of nodes, saying that these are the delegates, or we can say witnesses, So every network user will certify that trust. Suppose if I want to become a miner, or I want to consider in my institute 34 faculties are there. I want to sign a document and I want to upload this document on the blockchain. So the sign should be, this sign should be verified by the all the nodes. So I am performing one transaction among these 34 faculty, but I am not trusting on all these 34 faculty. So I will elect some of the trusted faculty. So like this, every network user, so like this, every faculty will show their trust on some of the witnesses. So we can say that out of 34 faculty, 14 faculty are the trusted witnesses. So though consider now, all the users are trusting on them because they are trusting on such nodes. So whatever blocks will be mined by such trusted node, consider to update my DLT because I have given vote to these particular nodes. So in this case, network users will elect the witnesses and delegates to generate the block. That means network user is allowed to certify their trust on one of the witnesses who will be validating the transaction and generating the blocks with them. A certain amount of witnesses selected by the network to obtain enough decentralization. So I will select, suppose out of 34 faculty, I can say that these four faculty or these five faculty, among these five faculty, whoever will generate a block, that I will update into my node. So that block I will update my node. But each witness will be assigned a fixed schedule, let's say 2 seconds to produce a block, just to speed up the block generation, speed up the transaction process. So here the system is relies on the reputation, and dishonest witnesses can be voted out of the system. Means those nodes who are not trusting on the some of the nodes, those untrusted nodes will never get a chance to mine a block or to create a block. So this is called deterministic selection of the block producers, which will allow the fast confirmation time. Then federated Byzantine agreement, which is widely used in Ripple and Stellar. Here participants rely on this small set of validators that each member considers trustworthy, same like the delegated proof of stake. And members will accept the transactions that are previously accepted by their trusted validator. So let's say it is kind of indirect trust among the nodes. Let's say I'm trusting you on X person, and that X person is always accepting the data from the Y person. So if that Y person is sending data to me, then I will always accept, because I know that X is, I'm trusting on X, and that X is always accepting data from Y. So this is indirect trust established between me and Y via X. So whenever I will get the data from the Y, I will always accept because there is a trust. Proof of authority, nowadays it is widely used in the permission blockchain and private blockchain. Here the block generation with proof of authority will require the special permission to one or more members to make changes in the blockchain. Make changes in the sense they can add the data into the blockchain. Now think about, I can take the example of academic organization only. Let's say the document. Whatever document you are passing, that for that students or faculty must have to follow the hierarchy. The document should be passed through the HOD, deans, and the higher authority director. Now director is giving, director is granting a permission to Dean Academy that whatever queries are coming relevant to the academic thing, you are eligible to approve all the queries. in which centralized authority will not come in picture. Centralized authority is the director of the institute. But consider the set of Dean Academics. Means set of Dean Academics, I can say that Dean Academics, Associate Dean or Assistant Dean. So they are authorized to accept the data from the students as well as faculty relevant to the academic related queries. So here the permission is granted to this set of people. So they are only these people are allowed to make changes in the sense this only these people are allowed to update the data on that on academic related database. Like for example, one member holding a special key may be responsible for generating all the blocks. But again, it is going more towards the centralized system. And there is always trade-off. If you will go for more decentralization, like in proof of work, it will automatically establish this trust and there will be security that data will be always correct and data will not get modified once it is uploaded over blockchain, because it requires 51% of the confirmation from all the available nodes. So that is, I can say, that full decentralization. But when we are reducing the number of validators, or I can say authorities, who can mine the block or who can validate the block. So when you are reducing the decentralization. So in that case, it will give you the good speed. So in blockchain, this is a trade-off like speed versus the decentralization. Nowadays, suppose let's say there are four authorities. Every time the first authority, suppose let's say all the authorities are numbered by the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's say 5 authorities are there. Now if every time only first authority is getting a chance to mine a block and others are not getting, so it will become fully centralized. So to avoid this problem, nowadays in literature they are combining proof of authority with the round robin approach. You know what is round robin. So first, during the first iteration of the block, first authority will get a chance. For the next iteration, second authority will get chance. Like this, all the authorities will get a chance to mine a block and to update this data on the blockchain. Now the question is, if one of the authorities misbehaving in this sense, is holding data, that whenever that authority is getting a chance to mine a block, he's not creating a block, so that other authorities will have to wait and it will delay the transaction process. In that case, they are also giving the threshold on time. If that authority taking more than some threshold time, then again through round robin approach, next authority will get a chance to create a block. So these are the variations of the proof of authority you can consider in this. Proof of elapsed time. This is fully hardware based and Intel Sawtooth is using you know that Hyperledger Sawtooth, which is developed by the Intel. So Intel Sawtooth is using this proof of elapsed time. Here, how I can identify the nodes, just to speed up the transaction process, I will identify the node which are having the less waiting time. Because ultimately to mine a block, CPU instructions will be required, means computational power from each node will be required. So let's say there are 100 nodes. Out of from each node, I will request for the what is the waiting time. So it is what is the waiting time for each CPU to process a block, and node which is having the shortest wait time, that can be elected to produce a block. So this, it can scale to the thousands of nodes. And it can be energy efficient because the block generation process is not going, or the processing power is not used from all the nodes. It replicates a fair and random block generation process without spending valuable resources like such as coins. This coin will see like it is a part of proof of burn, computational power, electricity. So if you want to become a miner, you must have to spend something, because at the end you are also getting some reward. So when you are spending something, and the cost of spending should be lower than whatever you are earning, so that all the nodes will participate in the blockchain working. And it is achieved by utilizing the new CPU instructions and trusted execution environment. So validated nodes request a waiting time from a trusted function in general purpose processor. The node with the shortest wait time will produce the block. So this environment will check. If my node is claiming that I'm having the allocated, means I'm having the shortest waiting time, then I'll be able to produce a block. But this environment will check whether you are having the shortest waiting time or not. But the problem with such type of consensus mechanism, it requires the dedicated hardware. So, and this is developed by Intel, so you must have to rely on Intel. So again, your trust is going to the single authority. Means you must have to trust on the Intel, then only you can work properly. So here, again, trust is required to a single authority instead of establishing this distributed trust among the nodes. Proof of activity. So we know this, the pros and cons of the proof of work as well as proof of stake. The advantage of proof of work is offering good security. Means we need the 51% of the confirmation. And proof of stake, it is reducing the number of nodes to validate the block. So it is speeding up the transaction process. The problem with proof of work is it is wasting a lot of resources. The problem with the proof of stake, difficult to establish the trust, because we are relying on the set of the entities. So why we cannot combine the proof of work and proof of stake? So the combination of proof of work and proof of stake is having the proof of activity. Means initially, when you are starting the blockchain, initially the transaction should be generated, the block should be generated by proof of work. Because as you know that initially calculating the hash, the hash value will not be that much lower. Once your blockchain will be, the length of blockchain will be increased, at that time proof of work will take lot of time. So initially you can go with the blockchain proof of work, and after that you can go for the proof of stake. So here block templates which are empty of the transaction are generated by the miners using our proof of work approach. So in the initial phase of blockchain, you can go with the proof of work. And then block will be validated by a group consist of the random set of people which are in the stack. Block validation is finalized when signatures are collected from all the validators in the group. But if nodes are not available, then new group will be selected. So it combines the advantages and disadvantages of the proof of work and proof of stake, like such as wasting of resources and issue with the validator like double signing. Proof of one, as I said, that to become a miner, you must have to spend something. You must have to spend something in the blockchain, so that if you will be successful on mining the block, then you will get certain reward. So it is kind of poker game. In poker, let's say suppose four people are there. Initially they are spending something, and whoever is winning jackpot, he can get whole money. So proof of burn is based on this concept. Like initially all the nodes are spending some coins in the blockchain, that I'm spending suppose 5 coins, some other are spending suppose 4 coins, like this. And they only can be participated to become a miner, to mine the blocks. Here, once out the nodes who are spending some coins, out of which whoever will become a successful, he will get or he will reward the some coins. Now suppose if I am spending 4 coins and I am winning suppose 2 coins from that iteration, then later I am winning suppose 4 coins. So I will be able to recover whatever I have spent to the blockchain to become a mine. So the proof of burn concept is working based on this. It aims to replicate proof of work cost for validation by charging validated nodes who pay in the coins to earn privilege of the validating block. Validated nodes commit coins that are worth. Once you are committing these coins, suppose as in my example I said that I am committing that 4 coins are there. So these 4 coins I am spending to become a miner. So later I will not be able to use those 4 coins. Means these 4 coins are not reusable. It is already burned. So validated nodes commit coins that are burned cannot be reclaimed to increase the chance of being selected by random selection process. And validation depends on the willingness to waste money. As a result, proof of burn result in unnecessary wastage of the resources. So instead of spending my, or instead of considering this criteria of like let's say computational resources or the coins. So in proof of burn, nodes are spending the coins. In proof of work, nodes are spending their computational resources. And you know that over the period of time, blockchain size is also increasing. The length of the blockchain is also increasing. So it will require the storage space. Now think, I have created the private blockchain within my organization. And I have suppose 5 or 6 nodes, because in private blockchain we will not have more number of nodes. Suppose let's say I have 20 nodes. All the nodes are having a storage space. Suppose I can say 1 TB. All the nodes are having storage space 1 TB. And you know that to make this blockchain for long running, I need more storage. I will need more storage. So in this case, the nodes which are committing their hard drive space, then they will get a more chance to produce the next block. So with proof of capacity, you can take the storage space of the nodes, because see, when you are becoming a node, you are also spending your hard drive space, because you have to maintain the copy of the blockchain. So if you are having the higher storage space, you can get a more chance, because we know that you are having the higher storage space, so at the end length of the block, or you can store the more number of blocks later. So this will create a more chance for producing the next block if you are having the higher storage space in proof of capacity. So this is, again, you can go with the any criterion. So till here I have covered the criteria. You can spend the computational resources, you can spend coins, you can spend your hard drive space. If I'll consider the smart grid, which we are currently implementing at NIT Goa, Now in smart grid, you know that currently renewable energy sources are being used, and all the I can say that house owners, they can put the renewable energy sources like solar PV or small wind turbines. They can put it on the rooftop of their house and they can generate the energy. So these nodes who are able to, I can consider all the householders can be considered as. So the nodes which are generating more energy, more renewable energy. So when they are using these renewable energy sources, they will emit less carbon in the environment. So if I want to maintain the blockchain for giving incentives to the nodes, how I can select the nodes which are generating more renewable energy can become a miner. So that blockchain can be sustainable, I will have good choice because they are spending their resources to generate the more energy, and once they will be the miner, they will get the reward. So based on the application, you can also define, but this criteria, defining the criteria, whatever criteria you are considering while considering the distributed consensus. In this PPT, I have covered only general consensus mechanisms, but you can also come up with the new consensus mechanisms based on your application domain. So now we'll see the blockchain taxonomy. So in literature, mainly two types of blockchain is considered, like public blockchain, private blockchain, and new blockchain is consortium blockchain. In public blockchain, the number of nodes will be at very large scale. In private blockchain, only dedicated nodes will be there. In consortium blockchain, consortium blockchain is kind of like consortium cloud, in which only affiliated large number of nodes will be there. Same like the consortium cloud. In consortium cloud also, let's say I can say that media. So media is one of the domain. So whoever is from the media domain, they can have access to the blockchain. So it will have affiliated, consortium blockchain will have affiliated large number of nodes. So if I see the trust among trust factor in these three types of blockchain, the trust in public blockchain will be very less, because the nodes will not require permission to the nodes which in the public blockchain will not require any permission to become a node or to register as a node. In private blockchain, it is always permission blockchain. So in private, I can say private blockchain, like my academia blockchain. Let's say I develop one private blockchain at NIT Goa. So the nodes which will be selected by getting a permission from certain authority. So private blockchain is kind of that example in which trust among nodes will be high, because only a limited set of people will be there and they are from the same domain. Consortium blockchain, which will have trust among the nodes in between public blockchain and private blockchain. So we'll see that the differences and similarities of the public and private blockchains. And this public blockchain and private blockchain can be considered with the closed as well open. So closed and open are relevant to the read and write. Like open, that who can write the contents, and closed means who can read the contents of the blockchain. So public is always permissionless. If I'm considering the public with the close, then these are the applications can be considered. Means even though it is public, means anyone can give a vote. Suppose let's say voting example and voting records. So anybody can give a vote, so it will become public. But who can calculate vote or who can see the vote? So that is closed. So only limited set of people can read the votes. Writing can be done by the n number of people because it is public blockchain, but reading is by these only few set of people. But I can say that like Bitcoin, cryptocurrency, that anybody can perform the transaction, or like video games. So here open and close are relevant to the read write access. So kind of how application should be all. Betting should be always public, video game always public. So this type of application you can develop on the public blockchain, but it should be open also, that everybody should be able to read the data, like let's say in the Bitcoin. Bitcoin are more towards the public and open blockchain. Ethereum and Bitcoin are more towards to the public and open blockchain, where anybody can become a node to mine the data, anybody can perform the transaction, or anybody can read the transaction. So this will offer, public and open blockchain will provide more transparency than the others. Now, private close. So like the construction management, let's say not the tender, because in construction on blockchain, when you are going for the tender, it should be public tender. But in construction, let's say I can say construction is involving design and construction phase. So design will be done by the architect, then the engineers, and construction will be done by the contractors. So the nodes, this type of blockchain should be always considered as private blockchain, and it should be closed. Means only those people should be able to read the data, like law enforcement, national defense, military, tax returns. So if you see that when I am considering private and closed, means it will go more towards the critical applications. When I'm going for the public and blockchain, public and open kind of blockchain, it will not be like critical application. It is like our traditional applications. Private and open, let's say supply chain. Like if I want to go for the food grain trading. So in food grain trading, it will be among the farmers and among the limited set of people. And open means that how the trading is taking place, so it should be transparent to all the nodes, like governmental financial records, corporate earning statements. So Hyperledger and R3 Coda, because you know that the permission for access rights can be given by the Hyperledger or R3 Coda. So Hyperledger and R3 Coda are more towards the private and closed blockchain, while open and public blockchains are Ethereum and the Bitcoin. So this is the difference between public and private blockchain. Public blockchain is always permissionless. Anyone can join the network and read, write, or participate within the blockchain. They need not to take permission from any centralized authority. So if I'll ask you the eKYC, whether this eKYC should be public blockchain, private blockchain, or whether it should be open or closed, just think about it. It is decentralized. It is more decentralized because here large number of nodes are there. They are not trusting on each other. So we must have to run such blockchain with the proper consensus mechanism. So it is more decentralized and does not have single entity which controls the network, because permission is not there, so anybody can join the network. So they will have less trust among the each other. So no any single entity or no any single set of group, no any single group should be able to control the network, as like in the Bitcoin. Now on blockchain are secured, as it is not possible to modify or alter the data once they have been validated on the blockchain. Because consider, out of thousands of nodes, suppose few nodes are misbehaving, or if they are trying to modify the block, so only they will be able to modify their own copy, which will not reflect to the all the others nodes, because here no number of nodes are having the more here it is including more number of nodes. So if few nodes are not behaving properly, or if they are misbehaving, or if they are trying to alter the data, it will not reflect to the other nodes. But as I said, I'll cover the security problems later in case of public blockchain also. If I'm creating a bot and if I'm having the control of 51% of nodes, means I'm just I'm creating the 51% of virtual nodes. So I can have full control over the blockchain because the large number of nodes are mine. So I can create the valid copy of the data, valid copy in the sense my data copy will be valid, but it is including the wrong data. But everyone will believe on me because I am having the majority of the S-rate. S-rate in this is I am having the majority of control over the majority of the nodes. But that is very difficult to create such number of virtual nodes, and it is very difficult to control the public blockchain because it is over the period of time the number of nodes are increasing in public blockchain. So Bitcoin and Ethereum are well-known examples of the public blockchain that you know very well. Private blockchain. Private blockchain should be always permission blockchain. It works based on the access control, which restrict the people who can participate in the network. So you know that the access control. I think in other sessions you will see the working of the Hyperledger and Ethereum, which are I think scheduled. So I'm not going to touch into detailed structure of these blockchains. So there are one or more entities which can control the network, and this leads to reliance on the third party to transact. So again, in private blockchain, permission is required. Now the question is who should give the permission? But you know that you can like in proof of authority, that who will give the permission or who will grant the special permission to the set of people. Proof of authority should not be implemented in the public blockchain, because otherwise that's if central authority trust is there, as like in the proof of elapsed time, if the central authority, if there is trust is centralized, in that case the centralized authority, if it is misbehaving, then the nodes which have taken the special permission can control the whole network. So in public blockchain, you cannot go for the proof of authority kind of consensus mechanism or kind of proof of elapsed time consensus mechanism. Here, the only the entities participating in a transaction will have knowledge about it, whereas the others will not be able to access it. So this is a kind of private and closed. If only entities which are participating in a transaction, only if they are knowing about the data, then and others are not knowing about the data, so that this is fully private and they closed. So Hyperledger and of the Linux Foundation is a perfect example of the private blockchain. So what are the similarities? So if you consider the public or blockchain or private blockchain, both are append-only ledgers. Means both are having the append-only features. Here each node has a complete replica of the ledger, as like in the blockchain features. Validity of record is also verified in block in case of both the blockchains, and they will rely on the numerous users to authenticate it. Here the scale of or number of nodes will be different in both the case, but both the blockchains are relying on the number of users, not the single entity, to authenticate the edits. Now the differences. So order of magnitude is very less in the public blockchain as compared to the private blockchain, because the public blockchain is having the large number of nodes than the private blockchain. Level of access granted to the participant. This level of access grant means in public blockchain there will be always access right. So the access rights will be very more in the case of public blockchain than the private blockchain, because here in private blockchain we are controlling the access. Public blockchain is considered as more decentralized. Private blockchain is like kind of towards the centralized. It is not fully centralized, but it can be considered as a near to the centralized, because where limited number of nodes are there and they are trusting on the centralized authority. So this is the difference between public blockchain and private blockchain. Transactions per second will be very low in case of public blockchain, but transactions per second will be very high in case of private blockchain. where the number of miners will be less, number of validators will be very less, so the transaction process will be faster than the public blockchain. Scalability in case of public blockchain is very slow, because public blockchain is very slow. You have to perform transaction, and those transactions should be recorded on the thousands of nodes, same transaction. So the scalability is always low in case of public blockchain, but in case of private blockchain, you can have good scalability. Trust. In public blockchain, nodes are always trustless. In private blockchain, the integrity of private network relies on the creditability of the authorized node. So even in private blockchain, if the creditability of the authorized node is not good, then again it will become the trustless. But generally it will be trusted. Security. Security will be high in public blockchain due to the large. But in private blockchain, why security is not?
Hello, sir, you are not audible. Hello,
can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You were at the point of security.
Yeah.
Why security is not good in private? Yeah.
So in private blockchain, we have a limited set of users. Let's say suppose 20. Even though these are authorized nodes, but consider authorized nodes can also be the semi-honest nodes. Semi-honest means the protocol which is given to them, they will follow, but they will try to learn something from the whatever data they are receiving, and later they can perform attacks. So that is why, and here less number of users are there, that is why security less in case of private blockchain, but in case of public blockchain, security is very high. I will cover the security issues later, but you consider this in public blockchain due to the large scale of the nodes. Even if few nodes are trying to modify the data, it will not be reflected to the large scale of nodes. So that is why security is high. Energy consumption always high in the case of public blockchain. Because here every node is trying to perform the trying to mine the. So before starting the smart contracts, so till now whatever we have seen are relevant to the like cryptocurrency, because we are not putting any logic before performing the transaction. So till now, whatever we have seen in case of blockchain revolution, such kind of blockchains are called as blockchain 1.0. So blockchain 1.0 is the currency, the deployment of cryptocurrency in apps related to the cash and financial transaction. It is the decentralization of money and the payments. But later smart contracts came into picture in case of Ethereum, then Hyperledger, then many other blockchains like IOTA, Ripple, Coda. So they are supporting to put some business logic before performing the transaction. And that is the revolution to the blockchain 2.0. So blockchain 2.0 is the like contracts. And contracts are the subset of the blockchain. I can say subset of the blockchain. Contracts are not the different or independent from the blockchain. All those smart contracts were defined long back, but those smart contracts are going to be are already used into the blockchain 2.0 revolution. So the deployment these contracts, the deployment of smart properties, digital asset. So smart contracts are enabling blockchain to make it feasible for the more other applications than the financial transactions and cryptocurrencies. So blockchain 2.0 is the decentralization of the markets. where blockchain 1.0 was the decentralization of the money and means financial transactions. So even if in a decentralization of markets, let's say energy trading, I want to perform energy trading, then who can participate in energy trading? Who can perform bidding? What are the rules to perform the bidding? So all these, I can say policy, I can define into the contracts. So if I'm the bidder, some policies like XYZ policies are there. So when I'm trying to perform bidding, my transaction, first it will go to the contracts only. The contract will check my validity, whether I should be allowed to perform bidding or not. If I will be allowed to perform the bidding, and then only my transaction will go to the blockchain network, and then the nodes will validate whether this transaction is valid or not. After that, it will be added to the blockchain. So this is the, I can say that, as yesterday we have seen in enterprise blockchain architecture, on the top of that architecture, the first layer, top layer is the applications. After that, smart contracts are there. So from applications kind of means it is kind of front view or front end of your blockchain application. So through front end, transactions will be initiated, but those transactions will go to the contracts first. From these contracts, it will go to the nodes, and nodes will validate the transaction. Contracts are not going to validate the transaction. Contracts are going to see the policy, whether this transaction is valid or not, but they are not going to validate. Means they are checking whether this particular user is allowed to perform the transaction or not. But the block which is mined by the nodes will be validated by the nodes only, which will not be, blocks will not be validated by the node, by the smart contracts. And at the end, that block will be added to the blockchain. So this is the revolution of 2.0. Now in revolution 3.0, the blockchain will evolve with the 3.0 to make it enable for the new areas of like smart city, IoT, machine to machine, government, health science, art. So this is also enabled due to the smart contracts and blockchain. And typical application is solidity. Now what it takes in blockchain 4.0? So in blockchain 4.0, the scalability and speed of the blockchain is considered. So already platforms are under the development to improve the scalability and speed. And like if you see the traditional network, like 1G, 2G, 4G, and 5G. In 5G, you have a lot of, I can say, all the kinds of applications like cloud computing, grid computing, IoT, everything are merged with the mobile computing. Everything is merged into the IoT. Everything is merged into the 5G. So this is called 5G. Like web as a service is also offered in this 5G. So similarly, blockchain is also evolving from blockchain version 1.0, blockchain version 2.0 to the blockchain. Now in blockchain 4.0 revolution, researchers are considering the scalability and speed of the blockchain. So now we'll see the smart contracts. I can say that in blockchain version 1.0, you need not to consider the smart contracts if your application is only for the financial transaction. But if you are looking forward of the blockchain application, then you must have to understand the smart contracts, which can be part of blockchain 2.0 or blockchain 3.0. But smart contracts were considered or were proposed . He is a legal scholar and cryptographer. He realized that the decentralized ledger could be used for the smart contracts. So decentralized ledger, I can say that it is kind of peer-to-peer network where every nodes are getting some data and they are communicating this message. So you cannot say that blockchain is a new concept. Blockchain is a part of your distributed ledger. So distributed ledger, it means what? Peer-to-peer network. In peer-to-peer network, everyone is maintaining the copy of the data. So that is what distributed ledger, and blockchain is a part of that distributed ledger. So you can consider the self-executing contract, blockchain contracts, or digital contracts. So in this format, contract could be converted to the computer code. So whatever our traditional contract, I can say the simple example of our traditional contract. When you are going for giving your physical contract, there where you have to rely on some central authority. Central authority may be lawyer or some other agents, brokers. You must have to rely on such central authority. So whatever you are mentioning in your physical contract, which should be converted into your code. But this code should not be large enough. Means the size of code should be, in research it can be, it is considered that the size of code should be maximum 200 lines. Otherwise, also it will affect the speed of the blockchain, because every node who would like to perform the transaction, they will have copy of this code. So if I am performing the transaction, first that code will be initiated, means that code will be called. So it is kind of function calling. I'm going to call that particular code through the address. Even each smart contracts are having their own unique address, that is called the pseudo anonymous address. As like yesterday we have seen the wallet address for the user, similarly the address for each smart contract is also there. So through that contract, through that address, that smart contract will be called. And once that smart contract will be called, it will check the validity of the data. And then it will send this transaction to the nodes. And those nodes will create the block, and once that block will be mined and validated, a block will be added to the blockchain. So this is how smart contracts are working. So smart contracts are also a part of the blockchain. So this would also result in ledger feedback, such as transferring money, receiving the product or service. So policies you can define in terms of smart contracts. Now the question is, why smart contracts should be considered? Already I have given answer, but in the context of internet, I can say that internet was originally designed for peer-to-peer of sending messages and communicating information, like our email service. Email service is what? Peer-to-peer communication. It was not designed for the e-commerce platform. Means internet was designed for the peer-to-peer sending messages. While sending messages, you were not putting any policy so that it can automatically check the validity of data. So it was not designed for e-commerce platform. So nowadays, after the evolution, internet has split between these two functions, peer-to-peer as well as e-commerce. As a marketplace of ideas, the distribution of information on the internet can be relatively untrusted, because if you are considering e-commerce platform, it is difficult to establish the trust. Although lot of reputation based systems they are implementing over the e-commerce platform, but still trust is not there. And information is published by anyone and everyone in the theory can be judged by for themselves. But at the marketplace for goods and services, like a marketplace of value, the internet has not fundamentally altered the basic mechanism of how individual or corporate parties transact their business values. So to do this will require some kind of mechanism, and that policy mechanism is offered by the smart contracts. Like the form of the transaction may be digital, like for example, parties may use the email to exchange digital copies of the contract. So let's say I want to give my house on rent to you. So we both will agree on the terms and conditions, but how we can access such contracts with each other? Through mails or through we can not only contract, we can communicate other information like documentation, some fund, license, but where is the copy of this information? Getting noise from some of your mic. Yeah, so where is the copy of the, where is the validity of this data? Even though if I'm transmitting over the email, it is difficult. So there is no real change from the traditional brick and mortar transaction. If I'm transacting such information with you for rent, giving my house on rent, I'm sending all the contracts documents on mail. So you will say that you have sent me this data, but if something wrong is happened, I can say that I did not send data on behalf of me, my account was stolen, so somebody else had taken this account and he might have done the contract. So there may be a lot of repudiation in such kind of transaction scheme. So most commercial transactions are not peer-to-peer and still require central or controlling authority or other trusted intermediary to conduct the exchange. I can say that even if you are performing transaction over the internet, you must have to trust on centralized authority because you are using the third party service. So there is a need of trust and security, and that need is very high in such centralized system. So to address this, DLT is already in use in some form from last 10 years. Blockchain is a subset of decentralized ledger technology. So you can now put the smart contracts on the blockchain to address this issue and this issue to improve the trust and security in such centralized system. So smart contracts in turn are the subset of the blockchain. Smart contracts are kind of lines of code that are stored on blockchain and automatically execute when predetermined terms and conditions are met. Means, let's say I want to transfer money to you for my rent. So it will always check that how much rent I am transferring to you, whether I'm putting rent, whether I'm paying light bill. So this if else condition you can put. If the transfer amount is not above this particular value, whatever we have agreed as per the contract, so contract will check if your amount is not greater than that, whatever we have, whatever rent we have decided, then it will ignore that transaction. So for business collaboration, contracts are typically used to enforce some type of agreement so that all the participants can be certain of outcome without an intermediary's involvement. Take this example, crowdfunding platform, like product teams will share their projects and collect money from the supporter until a goal is reached. If such a platform is centralized, like Kickstart, the third party between product team and supporter. So if I'm using some third party, because supporters will not directly give fund to the product team. So they must have to use this some third party, like Kickstart in this example. Kickstart will collect the money from the supporters and will hold that money until the goal is reached. Once the goal is reached, that money will be transferred to the product team. Or if that goal is not reached from all the supporters, then this money will go back to the supporters who have given this money to the Kickstarter for this project funding. So this is the thing. Now in both the side, they need to trust on the Kickstarter. If Kickstarter will run away, then both the parties will lose their funds. And also, you must have to pay some additional fee to the Kickstarter as a like service, as you are taking service from the Kickstarter. But the question is how to establish the trust. So smart contract can perform the same crowdfunding action like sharing projects, setting goals and collecting, but without third party. You can put the code lines of code. So smart contract will receive the fund, means all the supporters will perform the financial transaction with the smart contract. So the smart contract will have address. So instead of performing transaction with the product team, the supporters will perform transactions with the smart contract. So smart contract, every time suppose first supporter has sent some value, that will be added into some variable, then second supporter will send some value, that will be added to the first value. Like this, that addition will take place. Now they must have set the some time that till this moment, if our goal is not reached, then this money should go back to the supporters. If that goal is reached, then money should go back to the product team. This is the case. So a smart contract can receive the fund until the goal is reached. If the project gets fully funded before the deadline, the money raised automatically goes to the product team. That means the whatever transactions are generated or created by the supporters, all the transactions will be stored at the contract. And then once it will fulfill the criteria which is set in the smart contract, once it will be fulfilled, then and then only it will go to the product team. If it will fail, the money will automatically goes back to the supporter. And here it is line of code, and I'll cover the properties of the smart contracts, that once you are deploying the smart contracts, it will be immutable. You cannot change, because you cannot change its address also. So once you are putting a smart contracts, it cannot be changed. So means both the parties will trust on the smart such kind of smart contracts, and they will rely on this. But still there are problems, because these are also this is also software code, smart contracts. So if there may be bug of writing the code, so those bugs I will cover later in security part. But if your coding is not secure, so that is why yesterday I covered that secure coding is also a part of the blockchain development. So if you know that how to securely code your software, then the contracts will not leave any vulnerability to the attacker. So limits of the current contract means physical contract, like it will not scale well because it will be among two or three entities. If you see here, it will be among the two sides. Means maximum very limited number of people will be there. So bespoke contracts will not scale well because these are limited to the certain number of people. But if you go for the smart contracts, same code you can reflect on all the nodes or who are taking part in that particular blockchain, same code can be reflected on all the nodes. So scaling is very good in case of smart contract compared to the physical contracts. Proliferation of parties decreases the efficiency. Now let's say when you are going for the housing loan and you are taking a loan for your house, so it is kind of tri-party agreement between you and bank, between you and the owner of that house, and there is an agreement between owner of house and the bank. So this is tri-party contract. If you see physical contract, if you might have experienced this, it is very complex and it is difficult to maintain. So this is the example of only three parties. If suppose 10 parties are there, if that contract is among 10 parties or 15 parties, that everyone has to rely on everyone has a different terms conditions with each other, then physical contracts will be always failed. It is difficult to maintain the efficiency of such contracts if the number of parties are increasing. Verification of performance is also an issue as the number of contracts and location of performance scale. Simple thing, if I am creating the two pages contract with you, it will be easy to see. And the performance of that contract means whether it is considering the all the requirements which are set or not. But if I am having the 100 pages of contract with you, it is difficult to see the performance of that particular contract, whether it will perform well or not. Trust is also an issue, especially in cross-border transaction, where local courts must enforce the performance and payment obligation. If I am performing the contract, let's say Goa and the Gujarat, I am creating a contract between you and me. I am in Goa, you are in Gujarat. Now the laws on certain things are different. Like for giving a house on rent, the laws in Goa may be different from the laws in Gujarat. So if I am giving this, then which laws should be applicable? And then such kind of physical contracts are difficult to create. And when the contracts are among the countries, then payment obligations will also be there. So these are the characteristics of smart contracts. Smart contracts are immutable. Once smart contracts are deployed, kind of code, it cannot be changed. So it will be long running. Means there is a disadvantage with these characteristics. Flexibility is not there. Let's say I am creating a smart contract for the construction management. So initially parties are agreed on simple thing, deadline, that this construction should be completed by 3 years. So this 3 years deadline will be set into the contract, and as this contract is immutable, now after 1 year, like you know, this demonetization, during demonetization some of the activities were delayed little bit. So if such kind of events will occur, or if market prices are increasing for the cost, so cost, whatever cost agreement is there, that will also not meet. So such changes, even though both the parties are understood that these changes are there, but such changes are difficult to replicate on already pre-stored contract. It is not there. So that is also one of the limitation of this smart contract, that it is difficult to provide the flexibility. Second limitation of the smart contract is it is difficult to put law here. Because if something is wrong happening, if parties are not or parties' intention, like in physical contract, we are putting one line. When we are doing MOU between two organizations, they are putting one line. This MOU is created based on each party's understanding and their intention. But it is difficult to draw such intention in terms of the code. So that is also one of the limitations. But advantages are there, that smart contracts are always distributed, means you can involve large number of entities. It will always offer the direct dealing with the customers. So in case of giving a house on the rent, we must have to rely on many people, like agents, then lawyers, and many people, brokers. It is having resistance to failure. The physical contract may be failed. If terms and conditions are not set properly, so after 1 year, that contract may be failed or may be broken. But smart contracts are having the resistance to failure. It is having good trust because it is distributed and everyone has set their own terms and conditions. So trust will also be there. in case of physical contract, even though I am making contract with you, I'll always keep that copy in my cupboard because I am not trusting on you. That is why I am keeping that copy of contract into. But if that copy, whether it will be standard or whether it will be available in my cupboard after 5 years or 2 years, if I am creating contract for more than 20 years with you, after 5 years, whether I will be able to get that copy back or not, it is difficult to maintain. So it is difficult to trust on this. Fraud reduction. Let's say physical contract. You are appointing some lawyer and two parties are creating the physical contract. After that, they may take your signature. They may take a signature by me performing the phishing with you. And they can change the terms and conditions. And that is why nowadays, that is why on contract, on each and every page, they are taking both the parties' sign. But still, it is difficult to address the fraud. So fraud reduction can be done in case of the smart contract. Cost efficiency, you need not to spend money, you need not to go, means if you go for the physical contract, you know that you have to make such contract on some stamp paper, then service charges will be there. So it will involve a lot of cost. So cost in physical contract will be more than the smart contracts. And record keeping, the smart contract, that whatever transactions you are performing, it will maintain the record of those transactions. In physical contract, it is difficult to maintain the transaction records. Means with this contract, what transactions we have performed, that log of transaction is difficult to maintain with the physical contract, but it can be maintained with the smart contract. So this is one of the example, like automated execution of transaction between the homeowner, these are two parties who are agreed on the some set of rules to give house on rent. So smart contracts are useful in many occasions to replace the human intervention. For example, in case of an estate agency, you can send keys automatically once the contract is signed and rental has been paid. The risk, the code remains vulnerable and can be corrupted. So risk is there. If this coding is not proper, if this code is vulnerable, so it can be corrupted. Otherwise, it will provide all these characteristics. So then what are the types of contract? I think I have only 15 minutes. So what are the types of contracts? So there are two types of contracts, deterministic and non-deterministic. Deterministic contract, they will not depend on any outside information.
Hello.
Madam, it looks like he lost.
Yes. Yes, he left the meeting. Let him rejoin. I'm trying to connect with sir. Just wait for 5 minutes.
Yeah, sorry, I'm connected. Actually, I got network interruption. Sorry about this.
No issues, sir.
Yeah, so there are two types of contract, deterministic and non-deterministic. In deterministic smart contract, we need not to depend on the outside contracts. Means whatever parties are agreeing on a particular terms and condition, they need not to rely on the external information. Take the example of if I am going for some I can say vehicle registration. So I am having the blockchain for the vehicle registration. In this case, who are the two parties? Suppose if I am purchasing the vehicle from some store. If I am taking this vehicle, I have to make some terms and conditions with that particular showroom, that vehicle showroom. But here the rules and regulations will be applicable. Rules and regulation means here RTO will also come in picture. So, but contract will be made between whom? The showroom owner and you. But here the rules and regulation means additional information will be outside, additional information will also be required from RTO. So that kind of contracts are the non-deterministics. So in deterministic contract, the contracts will not depend on the outside information on the blockchain, in which they live into bit and work efficiently. And blockchain network facilitating such contracts has sufficient information to make decision, like peer-to-peer lottery scheme. So in peer-to-peer lottery, the funds are held on the blockchain network and random numbers are also generated by the smart contract code. And whoever will be winner, he will get that fund. So in that, additional information will not be required. So at the end of lottery, the fund will be transferred to the winner's account via his or own address on blockchain network. So if you are developing such kind of contract in which additional information is not required or outside information is not required, then such contracts are called deterministic contracts. In non-deterministic contract, the network which is having the network means blockchain network, which is having the smart contract, will not have sufficient information to make the decisions. And I said that vehicle registration. So for vehicle registration, when you are purchasing a vehicle from the showroom, they will not have sufficient information to make a certain decision. So then you must require the outside party to finalize this decision. And such outside information will be provided by the oracle. As in cryptography, you might have heard about the encryption oracle, decryption oracle, which can help to give you the additional information. So, it is not visible. Let me share it again.
Yes, so now it is visible.
Okay. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
So the outside party is called like oracle, and decision about the value flow will be based on the human behavior or events like price drop and hike. So these are the additional information, or you can put the some prediction. Like external state does not always introduce the need for trusting an additional party. Take the example, in a driving license renewal scenario, the government is the trusted party anyway. And the concept of blockchain, the people do not want to rely on the government, on government terms and policies. They want to always establish the trust among the untrusted entity using the decentralized. So again, this is bringing the government, and government is the trusted party anyway. So we use the government as a validation oracle that will inject the external state. That will inject the external state into whatever agreement you have made. So like in a physical contract, we are always writing, suppose if disputes will occur between two parties who are signing into the particular MOU, for any dispute, they will be oblique to the, or they will be, they will have to follow the rules and regulations as set by the government of India. So if such kind of statements they are putting, but what are the rules there that they are not writing into the physical contract? So once such kind of event will be occur, then government rules and regulations will be brought into that contract. So this is called non-deterministic behavior of the contract. So such kind of contract will also come in picture. So I'm not going into the Oracle part. So this is a, like I can say that blockchain 3.0 or 2.0, like enterprise blockchain, in which a dApp application people are now developing, where on the top of layer, there will be application, that smart contracts, then the to compile and run the contracts will require the virtual machines. At like in Ethereum, we will have Ethereum virtual machine, and at the end we will have nodes to keep the copy of data. So it uses the smart contract and provides the user friendly interface to the smart contract, that decentralized application. Or traditional apps, how it was working, like currently we have mobile app or mobile app. So whatever request will go, that request will go through internet service provider to the data center. So here the code at the back end, front end is always distributed, but at back end side code is centralized, and data will be available to the centralized data center. But in dApp, the difference between our traditional app and dApp is this backend side process is also decentralized. So if you see here, the whatever requests are coming from the mobile users or apps, that will go through the smart contract, which is distributed among the number of nodes. So number of ISPs, and number of ISPs will share information to each other and store the copy of data on each of the nodes. So this is the difference between dApps and apps. This will be covered in detail in I think further sessions Ethereum, because dApps you can develop on the top of Ethereum. So I have, can you give me 2 minutes? I'll come back just.
Payal madam, this session is up till 12:30, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And then we start again at 2.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
We'll try to wind up this session by 10-15 minutes. Okay. Let's rejoin, okay?
And do we also rejoin back at 2 on the same link or a different one you send?
No, we are recording each session, so we'll share a separate link.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'm joined. Sorry for the interruption. Yeah. So the security is also one of the issue in case of blockchain, because blockchain is not like over the night it is coming from suppose some earth and people are just happily using it. Blockchain is also using our traditional areas or technologies. So nodes, you know that it is like computing nodes. So we'll require the security at node level. We are writing the contracts. So in contracts, bugs can be there. The contracts are what? Code. So if you have poorly written contract, then it will affect the working of blockchain. You can have dishonest miners. Then if miners are misusing the consensus protocol, then also it will affect the security. And what your transactions are getting performed or broadcasting of block, which is also performed over the network. So network vulnerabilities are already there. So if you are not considering the network vulnerability, so at data communication level or data transaction level, it may affect the security of those data or blocks. And application vulnerabilities are also there. I can say that already DOS and DDoS attack is famous or well known to affect the availability of the application. So at web level also security is required. So in blockchain you can consider security at different levels. So as I said that in proof of work we need the 51% of majority, but in case of public blockchain, it is very difficult to perform such kind of DOS DDoS attack. If attacker creates the multiple identity, can be virtual identity, can have control on overall blockchain network. Such networks can forward only the attacker's block, so that this attacker can always be winner every time, and these 51% of node will maintain only the blocks of this attacker. So whenever updation will take place, these other nodes from that peer, they may update the copy of the blockchain from their nearby virtual nodes. But this kind of attack can be possible in case of private blockchain. In case of public blockchain, it is very difficult. Also, as I said that application layer security is required. So as per study, if you see that DOS attack in quarter 2007, more than 75 Bitcoin sites were attacked through DDoS attack. So this attack should also be considered when you are implementing the blockchain, and you should have some preventive measures. And you know that when majority attack will come, it will always cause to forking a blockchain. And why? Because consider these are the blocks from the genuine nodes, and these are the blocks are from the majority of the nodes. Length of this blockchain will be increased. Ultimately, what will happen? These two blocks, which are genuine blocks, will be not considered, because in blockchain the consideration, whenever forking is taken place, the longest chain will be considered as valid chain. Double spending. So I'll quickly cover all the security issues, but I want to cover issues in smart contracts. Double spending. Suppose consider there is a malicious buyer and this is a genuine seller. He is performing same Bitcoin transaction in network. So this will go to this one of the group of network in this peer-to-peer. This will go to the another network. Now consider this transaction block is validated. So the confirmation of transaction will take place. So seller this Bitcoin is valid and this transaction is performed by the buyer. So seller will supply the product. Now from the another network, same coin is coming. So what will happen if same transaction is there and same blocks is getting reflected, then this will not be considered and this payment will be cancelled due to the double spending. So the buyer will get its money return back. The buyer will get the money return back, but supplier will lose the product. This is what the double spending. And based on double spending concept, there is a Fingry attack, brute force attack. Everything is relevant to the X number of confirmation, and these confirmations are, these type of attacks can be possible in proof of work concessions. So I'll quickly go to the smart contract attacks or vulnerabilities in smart contracts. This is also one of the good attack. Blacklisting through punitive working. So here what attacker can plan to do, that Alice would not like to add the block which is mined by the Bob. So this will be the normal scenario. There may be some blocks of Alice and there may be some blocks of the Bob. So whenever Alice will observe that there is a block mined by the Bob, Alex will try to perform forking of chain. In that case, this chain will be increased and this chain will be considered. So these two BOPs block will not be considered. So it is like blacklisting the BOP. How it can be possible? It can be possible through bribery attack also. Or Alice can give some bribery to some set of nodes. Say that you can work for me only. You should work for me, I will pay this much amount. This can be possible. Second thing, wrong message Alice can announce in the blockchain network, saying that I am having 51% of her S-RED. S-RED means that is the power required to validate the block. So even though Alice is not having that S-RED, but Alice is saying in the network that I am having this much S-RED. So if anybody will mine a block for block, if anybody will validate the block of Bob, then I will perform the forking. And once forking will take place, then validator will not get anything from the blockchain. Because why they will spend their computational effort on validating the block which are not going to be added, because that Alice is planning to perform the forking. In that case, everyone will not validate the block of the Bob, and finally only Alice blocks will be validated. So such kind of attacks can be possible. And wallet theft can be always happen through the phishing attack, and already success stories are there on the wallet theft. So even in your net banking case, wallet theft can be possible. The beauty of blockchain that the wallet can be stolen using your private key only. So if your private key not known to or if you lost your private key, then there is no mechanism for recovering your money from that wallet. And why this recovery mechanism is not there? So if recovery mechanism is there, means kind of backdoor you are asking. If such backdoors are available, then attacker can take the advantage of such backdoors and attacker can steal your money. And that is why there is no mechanism available for recovering the lost bitcoins. Now these are the sample contracts on Ethereum. If you see such contracts, you will be able to identify that what kind of attacks can be possible. Through this attack, DAO has raised $150 million before being June 18. And attacker tried to grab whatever ethers are there. Means attacker tried to grab this 150 $150 million ethers from this contract. But an attacker was managed to put $60 million under her control. And you know that whenever such attacks are happening, always the owner of such such contracts will perform the hard for. So in this attack, here it will allow adversary to steal all ethers from the simple DAO. So this is a simple DAO contract. So in this, credit will be taken place, and this is the withdraw function. Attacker will introduce the Mallory contract. So the attacker is introducing the Mallory contract. So adversary donate some ether from the Mallory. So here adversary donating the some ether from Mallory and invokes the Mallory's fallback. So this will invoke the Mallory's fallback function. Here if you see this function called 5, this is Mallory's fallback function, which is maliciously call backs the withdraw function. So once this callback function will come, it will withdraw this. So here what through Mallory contract, attack adversary trying to credit some amount at first instance. After that, this line five is continuously calling this Mallory contract. In that, every time it is withdrawing, means this message will go to here, withdraw. From this, every time this amount is detected. So if you see this line 8, it will be always successful because the credit will be always then greater than amount. Why? Because this line 9 adversary managed to halt this line 10. Line 9 will not be executed, and every time the money will be added to the withdraw. How this attack can be stopped, or for how much time this will go into the loop? There are three conditions. Either this Mallory's gas is exhausted, means you know that the gas value is here. So whenever you have performed the transaction, you must have to commit some gas value. If the gas value of this Mallory is exhausted, then this function will be interrupted. Otherwise, it will continue to withdraw this. Even Mallory has not credited an amount, but this will continue to withdraw it. Second, if the stack is full, or third, if the balance of DAO becomes zero. If the balance of DAO, whatever credit is there in this DAO, if this will become zero, then it will come out, because then it will not be able to withdraw. The overall effect of this attack is, with a series of these attacks, the adversary can steal all the ethers from DAO. So from this DAO, DAO stands for Decentralized Autonomous Organization, where multiple organizations will agree on this particular particular smart contract, and they will donate their value, means money, credit value, and which will be stored into this contract. So this credit variable will have the total amount available in this contract. And adversary has created this Mallory contract. This Mallory contract is deployed, and this is called an immutable bug, because using this contract, adversary is able to manage withdraw all these amounts which is available into this DAO. Now, similar kind of attack can be done using this immutable bugs vulnerability on same. So it will also allow adversary to steal all the ethers, but here adversary need not to call the fallback function continuously. It will be called only once by doing two steps. Means this function will be called for two times by doing the two steps. The function is to, first of all, the first step is to publish this Mallory 2. This is the example contract. This will be published by providing some small ether, because when you want to take participate, you must have to credit some amount. So advisory will put like one ether value. Then advisory will invoke attack to the donator one ether to herself. Means advisory donating to the herself, DO donate value to this. Means this attack is called to donate, and after that immediately it is going for the withdraw. It is denoting, it is donating to herself, and then it is going for the withdraw. The function will check, the withdraw function will check the user's credit is enough or not. If so, it will transfer ether to the Mallory. If you see here, when Mallory contract is withdrawing, the withdraw function will check whether balance is there or not. If balance is there, then it will be withdrawn, and already advisory has credited that amount. So obviously this credit message will be greater than the withdraw amount. So as in attack one, it will call, or this call will invoke Mallory 2's fallback function, which in turn calls back the withdraw. In this case also, withdraw is interrupted before updating the credit. So here this withdraw is interrupted before updating this credit amount. So every time when you are calling this function in a loop, every time this condition will satisfy, and then amount will be credited to the Mallory's contract, and this amount will not get updated. Means before executing the line 10, this contract will be interrupted. So in this case, the DO sent one ether to the Mallory 2 for the second time, and it will invoke her fallback again. Again, it is invoking fallback. So every time it will go, it is going into loop to get the money. And after that, Mallory can get whatever money is now withdrawn to the, whatever money is withdrawn to the Mallory 2 will be added into the owner's balance. So this is a kind of one of the attack on the Mallory's, attack on the Ethereum based smart contracts. Here, if you see the Drubixi, this is also one of the smart contracts. This is a contract which implements the Ponzi scheme. Here, construction name was unchanged. If you see the contract, this contract is published by attacker, but the constructor name is not changed. So whenever attacker is calling this contract, it will go back to the another constructor. So advisory can steal some of the ether from the contract. During the development of contract, its name was unchanged from the dynamic pyramid. Actually, it should be Rubixi, because this constructor should be part of Rubixi. So this constructor should be Rubixi. So whenever this contract will be called, the withdrawal of the money will be happen from this, through this constructor. Means it will call the dynamic pyramid contract, because this constructor name was unchanged. This is one of the immutable bug. This type of vulnerability is called as immutable bug. So whenever you are writing a contract, you must have to consider such kind of vulnerabilities. If you see here, multiplayer games keeping secret. So when the players are keeping secret, then also it will create a problem. So this contract implements simple odd even games between two players. Each player chooses a number. So suppose there are two players. I'm putting some value, you are also putting value. If sum is even, then I will be winner. If sum is odd, then you will be winner. So this is kind of contract which we have, which is deployed on Ethereum, kind of sample contract which is on Ethereum. So to take a participant, each player must transfer the one ether by invoking the function play. If you see here, by invoking function play, participants will spend one ether. If the amount of transfer is different, then it will go back to the player. Once the second player will join the game, the contract will execute. The winner is two. Once both two players will join, once both the players will join, then this function and the winner is, and the winner is will be called. And then the sum of values of these two players will be calculated. And if that sum is odd, then the first player will win. If the sum is even, then second player will win. So here an adversary can carry out an attack to allow always to become a winner in such kind of game. So adversary can impersonate the second player and waits that the first player has made the bid. So what I'll do, I'll not immediately take the participant. I'll not participate in such kind of game initially. First I'll wait for the another player. If the player is if one player is putting bet, then immediately I will go for the bet so that I should know that what is available on this. Although if you see that player field is private, if you see this player field is private, the adversary can infer the first player's bet by inspecting the blockchain transaction where he joined the game. Because even the player field is private, if you see this player field is private, but whatever he had done, that record will be available on blockchain. So due to this transparency, I can see that what is it bet, and accordingly I will put this value and I can be winner. So this kind of vulnerability is called as keeping secret.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Sir, how much time you will take?
I have around 4 to 5 slides more.
Okay, no issues, sir. Sir, we have few questions. Can we take it up so people who are not from security side can leave?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, sir. One of the question is: has Government of India designed policy for blockchain? If yes, from where we can refer?
What kind of policy you want?
Hiteshi madam is there?
Policies sir, on what?
Sir, I think it is regarding
yes,
that.
I'm right here.
Okay. Carry forward, ma'am.
Yes, sir, I had two questions. Somehow both parties agree on smart contract and they prepare, and then at the time of goods delivery or somehow they have some contradiction and now they are not ready to go ahead with the contract. So can they delete, can they remove, or can they modify the contract? And how, if they want to scratch, then what is the process?
In case of smart contract, as I said, that once that contract is deployed on blockchain, it cannot be immutable. Means you cannot modify it, and flexibility is also not there. Means you cannot make the changes over the period of time.
So, sir, it keeps on growing, the blocks keeps on growing, right? Till all the So, what is the highest limit? Because the business is going to be for years.
Yes.
So, yes. What would be the upper limit?
Such contracts are the always short-term contracts. I cannot say these contracts should be long-term, because if you are going for the long-term business, then contracts should be feasible, because in business there will be always unwanted changes.
Yes, because okay. Policy changes, business changes.
Yeah, obviously, even after 6 months, suppose due to consider COVID-19 situation, many industries are having change in their business policy. So yes. Such policies are difficult. Then they must have to come up with new contract, but they cannot replace the existing, or they must have to create the new platform.
Mm-hmm. And second thing, sir, has Government of India has come up with the blockchain policy? If yes, where can we refer it?
Miss, I am not understanding blockchain policies for applications or blockchain platform developments.
No,
actually,
no.
Still, I can say that see the not Government of India website, but you can go for the TC307 standardization for this. Actually, blockchain is still not standardized.
Yes.
So if something is not standardized, it is difficult to put the policy. And here, if policy from government side will come, then again it will be relevant to like centralized control.
Yes. Yeah.
Laws and regulations can be there, but those regulations and laws can be outside of the blockchain network, not within the blockchain network. And let's say government or e-governance applications. In e-governance application, the policies of government policies you can incorporate in terms of smart contracts for that particular application domain. But there will not be any general policy on developing the blockchain platforms. I don't think it will be there, or if it will be there, I have not referred it.
Okay,
but I don't think it will be there. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. That's all from my side.
I got one. Can you give working model example of the DApps? I don't have DApps example, but based use case I can suggest of the DApps is the university degree certificate. You know this this use case very well, but still there is no success story on such a use case, like storing the student's degree certificates or student's credentials on blockchain. And later, this kind of data should be accessible by industry people who are coming for the placement, or this data should be accessible by the student. But all these things should be done based on the student's consent. If student is giving consent, then and then this data should be accessible, because student is the sole entity, or students are having the ownership of this data. So without the student's consent, it should not be revealed to the other people. So such kind of criteria we must have to consider when we are looking for the particular application. So I would suggest that if you want to deploy, or if you want to work on any use case of blockchain, first of all, this is the way to do research in the application side. First of all, you see the application domain requirement, that what are the policies are there in such application. And then you see that how these policies can be converted into the contracts, what are the entities are there. So as like in our normal database-based applications, like earlier we were working on the railway reservation system. When I was doing my BTech, I did same thing. So in that case also, I tried to learn that how reservation policies are there, what are the rules, what are the norms are there, what are the entities are there. And we were drawing the ER diagram, entity means that is entity relationship diagram and workflow diagram. So all these things should be considered when you are also developing such application on the top of blockchain. But only thing, structure will be different. When I was working on railway reservation system during my BTech time, at that time I was looking forward the centralized structure. Now I have to look at the decentralized sector. I have to consider the blockchain characteristics which should be there. And as well as I have to consider the policy and requirements of the application which should be fulfilled. So I think in Ethereum we will see the more working model that how to develop the DApps. I think it may be in Ethereum lecture. I don't have any exact model, or I have not implemented any exact model of the DApps. It can be implemented over Truffle. And people are using the Ganache, Truffle, such Ethereum platforms. You can deploy DApps over such platforms.
Yeah, because at both the end, like front end and back end, if we are considering that decentralization, that's what making somewhat confusion. So that's what just I have asked in that question.
Even
okay, now I have got that idea, sir.
You got it. Even at NIT Goa, I created my own blockchain through Python, and I started from the scratch, and I am successful in that. But still I'm facing a problem at the front end side. I'm planning to go for the web application as well as the mobile based application to access that data. But it is not about like when we are using the database is not only for storing the data. Later we need to use that data also. So still there are a lot of questions available that once data are available on the blockchain, that data will be in specific format, not as like our traditional database system. So the stored data, how we can retrieve back later to perform analytics tasks. So if I'm retrieving data, like in database, we are storing data in terms of tables. And then we are applying the analytical analytics methods like data mining, machine learning, all these things. But in case of blockchain, can we directly apply such data analytics techniques on the data which are stored on the blockchain?
No,
that
sir.
So we must have to retrieve the data, then we have to put that data in the form of table. So again, there should be some middleware between blockchain and your analytical model. And middleware, if you are putting middleware, again you are going for the centralized system. So this,
yes, sir.
Please.
Will we be able to see in which all blocks or smart contract have been deployed?
No. You will be able to access that contract through address.
Address. So this block cannot be reused again after any years.
Means you are planning, you can incorporate new contracts because these contracts are also going to be stored over the blockchain. So you can go with the new contract, but you cannot change the existing whatever contract you have deployed on blockchain. That you cannot modify. That is the immutability feature.
Sir, this contract, are we writing in which programming language?
You can write in any language as per your blockchain. In Ethereum, they are using the Solidity.
So can we practice this, how this blockchain works using some free Ethereum? Is there available?
Yeah, lot of material is available to develop your own private blockchain using Ethereum. You can develop your own blockchain through Python. Such kind of blocks are already available. You can just search it and you can practice it. Even you can deploy your own smart contract also. So such material is already available.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, there are two more questions from participant. One question is how to incorporate such non-deterministic factors while framing the rules. This is in context with non-deterministic smart contract.
I'm putting one contract when specific condition will be there. As I said, when we are doing MOU among the organization, when any dispute is occurring, then it is a they must have to follow the rules and regulations by the government of government of India. Okay. In this case, when particular event is triggering, then and then only such contracts will be called. Otherwise, those contracts will be always available as ideal into the blockchain.
Okay, sir. Got it. And sir, one more thing. Can you please tell us about one use case where IoT and blockchain is used together?
I'm using IoT for two major projects. I mentioned in biodata also. I'm using IoT for the smart grid energy management, in which we are monitoring the energy quality, energy supply, and this data are monitored through the IoT sensors like smart meters, and this data we are sending to the blockchain, and then we are performing the various analytics tasks. Second is drinking water quality management. At your home, the water is coming, but whether it is drinkable or not, it is difficult to do. And if you are drinking such kind of water, then it may lead to some of the disease. So at every moment, if I want to monitor, I must have to put the IoT sensor. And to monitor the quality of water, already IoT sensors are there. So those sensors you can install on your water tap, And every time, or you can put the schedule that every after 4 minutes or 5 minutes or 4 seconds, it should send this water parameter, water quality parameters data to the blockchain. Means on what on blockchain I will write a one contract that I have to calculate, I have to make the decision whether this water is drinkable or not. If this water is drinkable, then this data will be added into my blockchain, means in my blockchain as a transaction. If water is not drinkable, it will be added as a transaction into blockchain, but at same time it should generate alert to my mobile. So these are the various applications. Even you can consider the construction management. But these are the high-end applications, I can say.
Okay. Right? And sir, if we use blockchain for eKYC or such applications, such domain, yeah, what consensus mechanism we should use? Because it is highly public and open. So trust is the major factor. Then which consensus we should use?
Close. Actually, eKYC application can be considered under the category of public and closed. Means your document should not be read by or accessed by other people. Only banks should be able to access your documents.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And proof of authority, you can use the proof of authority because only authorized person should be able to see your data or to create your. Means see, eKYC verification means you are submitting some data, your private data, to the people. Now those people should be trusted to you. So only banks can be trusted. Then authorized nodes should be only the banks. If you want to see the proper use case, eKYC use case, there is one paper published by me. You can just go through the Google Scholar, my Google Scholar profile, you will get that paper. We have tried to simplify the eKYC using the blockchain. And we have considered the set of, the set of rules, and we have put the security logics on this. So you refer my paper, it will be good.
Okay, sir, thank you so much, sir. And sir, there is a request from participants that they need this PPT because it is very descriptive and elaborative. So can you please share that with us?
Sure. Just all of you can hold for just two slides.
I'm just skipping
these security problems. So the overall status, because see, I'm covering the fundamentals of blockchain. So I'll cover everything in a detail. Now what to do next? So blockchain will create a $176 billion business value by 2025. So this is the future of the blockchain, which is predicted by Gartner. And you know that Gartner prediction is very good in case of technologies. These are the existing platforms. These are the existing consensus. We can come up with the new consensus. These are the 40% of the projects are, means US is dominating the blockchain market. These are the sectors you can consider. I have not taken a session on the application, otherwise I would have covered all these applications in detail, but due to lack of time I'm just giving the sectors only. Even in India, this is the current status of India in India since 2014. But from in India, from 2014 blockchain had taken hype. Before that, even many of the people, most of the people were not knowing about the blockchain also. So these are the major companies which are really working on the blockchain. Some are working on the platform side and some are working towards the application side. Government initiatives are also there. So because government is also feeling that there are some, I can say that value added services can be offered through the blockchain. So these are the major sectors considered in India, like land registry, IP management, academia, e-governance, energy management, asset management, automation, industrial automation, supply chain. But still, even blockchain is giving everything, but it is not with the cost. It is not at the free of cost. Means it is also having the challenges and limitations. And still, that much maturity is not there. So people are now looking forward maturing the blockchain. So when blockchain 4.0 revolution will come, at that time scalability speed, like 5G, like in 5G, what we have done, internet evolution, internet revolution. So similarly in blockchain also, blockchain revolution for 4.0 will address these issues. So when companies are working or everyone would like to enter into the blockchain, but first slide was what? That boss was asking manager that now what we should do, in which domain we should work. That manager is saying that blockchain. Why? Because he has heard from somewhere. He's saying that we do not want to left behind. And then boss has asked, what is blockchain? He said that AI, because he's thinking that it is automated, so it is AI. But it is not AI. So that much aware.
Hello, sir, your voice is not coming. Hello.
Can you see these slides?
No, sir.
Yeah. Now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I mean, we know that many organizations, they are spending their money and effort. That is mostly, as per survey, it is saying that it is due to the technological hype and to compete with the others. Means if they will show that we are into blockchain, so they are feeling that because it is competition, everyone knows about this is a big buzzword about the blockchain. And we can grow business with the use of advanced technologies, but without understanding whether it is required or not. So there is a need of careful analysis and risk assessment before moving your business into the blockchain. Need to understand the business requirement also. Otherwise, you know that our traditional systems are also working well. If a fully trusted environment is there, like in institute, if you are trusted environment, then why you are going for the blockchain? So the question is, whenever you are doing research on the application side, the first question should come in your mind that why blockchain I should apply. Then you will be able to find out that what are the requirements you have and which are the requirements you are trying to fulfill using the blockchain. So need to prepare the application specific guidelines, because still it is having the lack of trainings and lack of staff to do maintenance of the blockchain, to develop the blockchain, or to make client convincible to use the blockchain. So application specific guidelines are required. Ultimately, I can say that there is a need to save effort and money. So before jumping into the blockchain, you must have to do in-depth feasibility analysis of the blockchain for a particular application domain. Then you can transform your business from your traditional system to the blockchain. And these are the sources acknowledgement, which I will share with you. So from this PPT, you can see. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. On behalf of all the participants in JEC pattern, I would like to thank you for covering all the cryptographic fundamentals, then all the basics of blockchain, who are miners, how proof of work works, then different consensus with trade-offs between speed and trust, then type of public and private examples with excellent bifurcations between applications which fall under which kind of blockchain, then what is read-write permissions, and then blockchain revolutions, smart contracts, and how it differs from public contracts, and what sectors in which we can use this blockchain to gain the trust, confidence. And so thank you so much for your valuable knowledge sharing with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me in this FDP. Yeah,
thank you, sir. Okay, sir. So to all the participants, we'll start our next session at 2 p.m. I'll share the link for the same. Thank you.